He's got his assistant to him.
Got my special helper.
Good.
Had to pick him up from helper school.
Right here.
All right. Remember the rules, okay?
I'm all set.
I can pause it.
Is that, is that a leapfrog or a, what is that you have?
iPad.
Oh, that's an iPad. Ooh. That's a lot.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, well, we're looking at, I forget what it's called for the little ones.
I'd like to thank the Planning Commission for allowing me to join y'all and speak this evening. As you know, my name is Randall Toussaint. I'm the Vice President of Economic Development at the Cumming-Forsyth County Chamber of Commerce. And I have the greatest job on earth. I have the responsibility of working to improve our economy. A lot of folks often ask, what does that entail and what does that mean? Tonight I was asked really to give you a quick overview and an update about it, and to talk a little bit about how we're growing and expanding. So I'd love to do that and love to take questions along the way. Keep this very brief and informal. I know that there's a heavy agenda, a lot of things you'll have to discuss. So I'll try to just cover a lot of the high points and just go from there. But I brought a couple of items just for us to look at as we're talking along the way. Pass one of those around. And because I also work for the greatest chamber of commerce on earth, I brought some of our lovely newsletters for y'all to take a look at too. But we often get asked the question about what is economic development? And that means different things to different people. I tell the story a lot about last year. I was giving a speech at a Rotary Club and telling them about how the new University of North Georgia was going to get opened over on Pilgrim Mill. Nothing. No claps, no applause, nothing at all. So I thought about it. I said, all right, let's share something else. And just kind of grabbing at straws, and I thought, you know, we just recruited a great company from South Korea. It's called IUS Technologies. They're proposed to generate up to about 150 new jobs within our community. Nothing. Nothing at all. So by that time, I was pretty much grabbing at straws, and I thought to myself, what the heck can I talk about? And it dawned on me, I said, we're getting a brand new Cracker Barrel on standing ovation. But it just goes to show you, economic development really does mean different things to different people. And we often get asked, what exactly is economic development? And from our standpoint,
yes.
And I'm not seeing a feeder, I guess, coming back.
No, is it not connecting?
Let's see if we can trip that over. But from our standpoint, it really comes down to a standard definition. There's a commonly used phrase that it involves efforts that seek to improve the overall quality of life of a community while enhancing the tax digest and growing incomes within the tax base. And that is a very wordy definition that simply means it comes down to the community. And more specifically, how can the community work together to grow and enhance the economic vitality of the area that we live in. And if this isn't working, it's fine. I can deal without it. I'm easy.
Let's try it real quick. Is it F8 that usually resets that?
Let's see.
Does that do anything? Because that's not on our projector, so I don't know where that came from.
It's pretty wherever it is.
That's not on your computer either?
No.
Well.
Someone somewhere has a great view.
Generally, it's on the PC.
That's all right.
Is there an input select on it? Awesome.
Tell you what.
Input select.
Who's voting for what here? Anything?
VGA.
You're a VGA. Let's give that a shot. If not, we'll roll without it, Randall.
That's cool.
No, back to Antarctica.
Good deal.
All right, we'll go without it. And honestly, I like it a little bit better this way. This is kind of a way where we can be intimate and just talk a little bit and take questions along the way. But really, economic development, as I mentioned, comes down to the community and how we can work to really grow our economy. Now, in our shop, Forsyth County, we really focus on three things when it comes to economic development. It's business recruitment, which is the part that you see all the time in the paper. It's where we bring out those gigantic scissors, cut the ribbons, and roll out the red carpet. And although that's the part that gets the most fanfare, we really only spend probably about 15% of our time on the recruitment aspect of what we do. A large bulk of it comes down to the second part of that three-legged stool, which is actually business retention. That's what I like to call closing the back door. It's doing things to make sure that the local environment and the local economy are fruitful in order to help grow a company. It's working with the company to figure out what their long-term growth strategy is and then identifying the roadblocks that might impact that strategy and removing them. It's working to figure out where their new markets are, whether or not they can consolidate their logistics centers, or create a good school system. But the most important thing really is the third leg of the stool, which is business expansion. After you've brought a company in, you've helped the company to stay here, and you've improved the overall quality of life and the environment in which they do business, you have to help the company grow. Pleased to say that we are now at a point after the economic downturn where we're seeing the return of expansions. We're starting to see companies who are looking at growing and expanding in their market now. We are a very blessed community. We, as you can see on our little cheat sheet here, have been ranked as the seventh fastest growing community by Forbes magazine. And that's the seventh fastest growing community in America. We're one of the only communities to maintain that ranking both in the 2010 recognition of it, and then also in the 2013 recognition. Now, the other thing that's important to bear in mind is that we're also ranked by Forbes as the 13th most affluent or wealthiest community in the nation. Those are two distinct features that are rarely held by the same community at the same time. Got a cheat sheet here for you. We're also have been ranked as the second best place to get ahead in America, as well as one of the 100 best communities for young people. The reason I mention those things is we're starting to see a very strong trend. Companies that were able to survive the economic downturn did so by first trimming the fat, figuring out how they can go lean, and then they started cross-training their employees so that way they can take on more titles and more responsibility, and so that way they can be lean and nimble and look at growing into different markets. The reason I mention all that is there's a new shift. 5 years ago, if you would have asked what's the most important thing that a company pays attention to during a recruitment or expansion project, I would have told you it's all about incentives. Now it's completely different. Rather than incentives being the cake, it's the icing on the cake. What companies are more interested in now is, what's the quality of life like? Is this the absolute safest decision I can make in terms of where my company can move to and grow? And I don't say that facetiously. When we hold up the rankings that we're the seventh fastest growing community, that we have been ranked among the 100 best places to live, we actually are able to circumvent a lot of challenges. And the unique reason for that is because we're poised to help a company grow. Now, we don't just go out and recruit any company. We work in very specific target markets. Our fastest growing market is healthcare. Now, everyone in this room has probably been here longer than I've been here. And from what I've been told, the crane at Northside Hospital hasn't moved since they started building that hospital originally. The reason that's important, though, is when you start thinking about anchors that help to bring in other subsidiaries in a target market, a hospital is one of those. After Northside Hospital built their women's care center, in their first year, they birthed almost 2,000 babies. Now think about that, 2,000 children being born into a community where most of them would have insurance and would go into households that have a household average income of about $102,000. It's phenomenal. That caught the attention of Children's Healthcare, who then quickly moved into the market and built a 6.1 urgent care center at, I still want to call it the Avenues. I call it the Avenues. It's the Collection. But they built it over at the Collection. That caught the attention of a lot of other medical equipment manufacturers. We are now the home of the manufacturing division of Shionogi Pharmaceutical, one of the largest manufacturing facilities for pharmaceuticals in the world, behind McKesson. We're also one of the top firms in terms of being able to provide logistics, or communities for providing logistics support, the third-party logistics providers who are bringing goods and services for the pharmaceutical industry through Georgia. It's outstanding. Talk about healthcare also. You often think about the physician side of that, but medical equipment manufacturers are also another great key feature that has begun to emerge. And as we go forward, that's one of the key sectors that we're going to try to grow a little bit. Manufacturing is also another great industry that's continuing to grow. A lot of the talk has happened over the last few years about China and how China really has taken over manufacturing globally. But there's an interesting thing that's starting to happen. And as I'm going, if there's any questions, feel free to dive in. When you kill the PowerPoint, we can talk. But with China, the cost of wages is actually beginning to rise at a rate where folks are forecasting within the next 6 years, even some predict, we'll actually start seeing their wages equate to some of our wages. You also take into the account the rising cost of fuel, and in terms of transportation, getting goods and services from overseas back here to the U.S. becomes almost cumbersome. But when we're talking to our local manufacturers, there's two things that really have led to the shift of moving manufacturing from overseas back here to the States. First, there's a copycat issue. If you look at bringing your product to China, one manufacturer actually mentioned if you bring your product there and it takes off, within 2 weeks you have to start worrying about, is there a factory around the corner that's going to start making a cheaper version of your product? The confidentiality agreements that hold true in the U.S. aren't necessarily intact overseas. The other thing that our local manufacturers have told us, which is outstanding really, is that as they begin to hear back feedback from a lot of their customers about how they can tweak a product, say they make a widget and someone says, well, I need that widget to do XYZ, they can't necessarily go to China and ask for their R&D division in China to retool that product and then get it back into market quickly enough to yield a revenue profit. GE actually came up with one of the first examples of bringing that R&D division back from China. They moved theirs to Florida and then created an opportunity for them to start retooling products and getting it back on the market quickly. And what they began to see was that it increased their sales. We're starting to see the same thing locally. We are now the home of 515 manufacturing companies in Forsyth County, which is outstanding. What's unique about that is we're home to a lot of heavyweights as well. Every single, I love telling this, every sausage patty that gets sold in McDonald's in the southeastern region of the United States, you know where that's made? Cumming, Georgia, Smithfield. They're getting ready to go through a $10 million expansion that's going to allow for them to actually move into the crumbled meat market. So all your crumbled sausages that you'll see on frozen pizzas, even if you go and buy them in the grocery store, chances are that'll come from Cumming, Georgia. But it's outstanding. Manufacturing continues to grow and thrive. We also have technology and data centers as another key one. We're home here in Forsyth County to the data centers for New York Life, Publix, JM Family Enterprises, who is actually the data side of Toyota. They're all located here in Forsyth County. We have one of the strongest dual feed fiber optic networks, which is very quietly kept secret. right along exit 12. But the reason I mention that is we're poised to see that industry grow as well. From the technology standpoint, just had a great meeting today, for example, with two companies that are poised to grow in the technology sector. One's a small company that moved here called CSA. Little known fact is that stands for the Canadian Standards Association. Yes, sir?
You brought up the fiber optics. I noticed they were putting it on Georgia 400. Is that the fiber optics we use for our data centers?
Actually, it's not. But I will say the fiber that's going in along Georgia 400 is being installed by a group called World Fiber Technology, who's also located in Forsyth County, Georgia. They've got the contract to install most of the fiber throughout the state of Georgia on behalf of the Georgia Department of Transportation. But in terms of what's being used by the data centers, there's a separate grid there. The reason it's called a dual feed fiber optic network, well, great question, by the way, it's a gigantic ring of fiber that encircles the Meadows Industrial Park. It runs from about Stony Point and Cabot Parkway all the way down to McFarland Parkway. The reason that in itself is important is because there's a fiber ring that shoots up north towards Dahlonega, another one that connects to one of the country's largest fiber networks down on Marietta Street. And if any side of that fiber optic ring gets severed, there's two sides, that's right. If any of that fiber optic ring gets severed, as a result, they can patch in fiber channels from the other side, so it never goes down. I didn't mention this initially, but UPS actually has their, one of their largest data centers in the country, right there within that network. And in that data center, they track most of all of our shipping that goes on. If you look online and track your package, that data is actually being funneled through Forsyth County Fiber, which is phenomenal. But again, when you think of Forsyth County, you might not think of us in that way. But that is our economy. That's where we're growing. As we go out and recruit new companies to move in, average community about our size, we were told by the Georgia Department of Economic Development last year, goes after about four major projects a year. These are the Caterpillars, the Baxters. They bring in close to 1,000 jobs in a year, and your goal is you land one out of those four, and you're good. But that's not us. Our economic development strategy in Forsyth County is tooled on small to mid-sized companies. Northside Hospital is our largest private sector employer. I mentioned we have about 500 manufacturing companies. They're all small to mid-sized firms. Our goal is to grow those firms over time, keep adding the jobs and add the capital investment. In the 40s, when you looked at mill towns, the key thing that happened is that the mill employed everybody. The mill closed, everybody was unemployed. Same strategy kind of holds true today. We have so many diverse industry sectors and so many small to mid-sized companies that as the economic downturn hit and we saw housing kind of pull away, we were able to also tap into other markets, and it helped us to stay afloat and rebound a little bit more quickly. Now, I mentioned the 1-out-of-4 ratio. Our community, because we go after small to mid-sized companies, we also want to generate ballpark about $40 million in capital investment a year, just like the other communities about our size in Georgia are trying to do. But to do that, we go after about 20 companies in a year, which means rather than going after four leads in a year, our job is to go after four per month. And our team has the responsibility of closing one out of every four leads in order for us to get our goal. Pleased to say, right now we've got a closure ratio of 36%, which is phenomenal. This year alone, we've generated about $44.8 million in new capital investment by working on roughly 18 projects. And they're, at this point, currently poised to generate about 523 new jobs. It's amazing. Very blessed community.
Where do your leads come from?
Spies. I say that jokingly, but it's kind of true. To tell you the truth, it come from a large different array of sectors. The traditional route that community gets leads is usually through the Georgia Department of Economic Development. They have partners that work all over the world, and they generate leads and pass that back to the department, and the department creates RFP situations for communities to make proposals to recruit that project to our community. Usually when that happens, we get about 20 hours, if that, of turnaround time. It's usually less than 24 hours to complete about a 14-page proposal. It can ask you anything from tell us the top 10 businesses in your community to how many left-handed people are located within a 5-mile radius from this one location. And I don't say that jokingly, I actually had to do that before. The unique thing though is we rely heavily on our partners such as our planning staff here at the county. I've bothered Tom on many a night just to ask for some quick data and see how we can package that in a way where it resonates with the audience we're going to pitch to. Should also mention, when we, in those scenarios, when we pitch, we tend to speak blindly. So there will usually be about four people that will walk into a room. We won't know what the company's name is. We won't know what they do. All we'll know is what their square footage requirements are and what their overall growth goals are and how many jobs they'll create, as well as how much capital investment it will bring to the community. And our job is to close the deal, usually by talking about our community and talking about our great quality of life, and it's not a hard sell. Yeah, trick of the trade, I mean, usually the guy asking you the numbers questions, the finance guy, the overall strategy guy is the CEO. There's workforce questions, it's usually operations or HR person, but when we sit down and we talk, everything we mention is confidential. There's usually, at any given moment, like I had mentioned before, about four projects we're working on at that time, at any given time, that are all usually confidential in nature, and we compete. Now, that's the traditional route. What our community does, which is very unique, we proactively target groups. For example, we are home to about 68 international companies. About 17 of those have their regional or their national headquarters here at Forsyth County. And it's names you know, like Siemens, Trox, Hansgrohe, and you can hear the German ring in a lot of those. The German companies, particularly the Black Forest region of Germany, find Forsyth to be very accommodating. It resembles the Black Forest region to start with. So there's a sense of home, a sense of place, as Jane Jacobs says, when you come through Forsyth. But the other unique thing is there's other German companies. That is the strongest selling point. There are other companies who have already made it that can offer mentorship opportunities to new companies coming here and looking to grow. The reason I mention all that is as these German companies recognize that they want to penetrate the U.S. market, in their minds, they don't really know where Forsyth County, Georgia is. They know that there's a place called Hollywood where all the movies are made. New York has a big green lady in the harbor. And then there's Atlanta where they always get laid over for a flight. Our job is to kind of hone in on what all that really means. So we've actually created a team of, it consists honestly of volunteers, the spouses of the CEOs of the German companies who are located in Forsyth County. Have volunteered to donate usually about 2 days a week where they'll come in and help us to call Germany or go meet with companies when we bring them into town for a red carpet tour. And it's amazing. Once we bring them here, I'll do the song and dance, the PowerPoint, and we get in the car and in German, we'll hear the CEO that's flown in. He'll ask, so is all that he said really true? Where do your kids go to school? Where do you buy Spätzle? Where do you got to eat? And that's when the real deal making happens. It's one thing for me to say it, but for a mother who's brought her children here and her husband is an executive in a German firm to say, here's my story. Here's how it worked for me. And here's how it can work for you. That's when a relationship gets built. And that's really what's closing the deals. It's no longer, as I mentioned before, incentives. But now it's about building that relationship and talking about what will happen after your company gets here.
Do you have a shortage of German translators around here?
We have a shortage of Chinese translators, but German,
yeah, I can imagine.
We actually do have a good amount of folks who volunteered. I lived in Germany for quite a bit growing up, and then like I mentioned, a lot of the spouses of the CEOs coming in.
So you didn't find that?
But believe it or not, a lot of the CEOs have volunteered their time and actually offer up their factories while they're in production during our red carpet tours. And I tell you, it's one thing to sit in a room like this and talk about the value of Forsyth County, but it's another when you can walk through a tour where you're going through a factory and then a CEO walks out of his office, comes to the factory floor, and tells you his story and says, if you ever need anything, you call me. And without any word, I mean, that's a connection whether that company chooses to move to Forsyth or not that they value. And that word spreads. I think for that reason, Georgia's really become a powerhouse now for international growth. Site Selection Magazine ranked us as the number one place to do business in America, ranked Georgia itself. When we start taking a look at the numbers in terms of expansions, last year I think it was 38%, roughly 40% of all business expansions that took place in our region, the northeast region of Georgia, happened here in Forsyth County. And we're poised to surpass those numbers. You know, I said we're at 44.8 million for this year. The year's not over. We're still working on trying to get a couple of these in before that finish line horn goes off. But I've talked a lot. I just want to really give you an overview of our market, about our recruitment strategy, what we're working on. Love to take any questions and see if there's anything we can offer some feedback on as well.
Appreciate the information.
Go ahead. Sorry. Go ahead.
I appreciate the information, and I think it's the business opportunities are very important here because obviously what a lot of sprawling here counties have with sprawl is that all the traffic moves one way, so you're only using half of your roads. And if there's a way, one way that you can reduce congestion is just building opportunities farther up so that traffic can move both ways in commute hours. But what type of incentives can a county offer to encourage businesses to develop? I know right now our most of the business development happens on the very south end. Is there Are there opportunities to try and do that on the north end?
There are. I've got a little cheat sheet just want to pass around to y'all. These are, it's an example of what we'll typically show a company during the red carpet tour. It's pretty boilerplate or vanilla in terms of our stock package, and then we'll work on custom things. But in terms of the northern area, I have to tell you, our opportunity zone is something that really raises a lot of interest for a lot of companies. Now, I'll touch on this in a moment, but an opportunity zone was created. Opportunity zones themselves were created by the Georgia legislature in order to allow for communities who typically couldn't recruit strongly and had economic challenges to be able to attract quality jobs and capital investment. Now, the reason that's important is because the state of Georgia ranks every community on a tier system. Naturally, we have one of the strongest economies in Georgia, so that means that in our tier system, we actually aren't able to offer the maximum amount of job tax credits. In Forsyth County, if a person were to create new jobs, they would have to create a minimum of 25 jobs to be eligible for the Georgia Job Tax Credit Program, and they could generate 1,250 new job or $1,250 ballpark for every new job that they created with that minimum of 25 jobs after that's been established. Now the maximum again is 3,500. In an opportunity zone, all those caveats change. You are eligible for $3,500 in new tax credits. You only have to create two new jobs. Outside of an opportunity zone, it's limited to typically manufacturing, distribution, or technology firms. There's a suite of target markets, but in an opportunity zone, any company can. Publix grocery store, if they want it, could apply for tax credits. Now, these zones are normally drawn in areas where people do not want to typically move into. That's the key. There's usually a challenge about blight or economic conditions, or that's an underdeveloped market. So the zone is put there as the recruitment tool, the carrot, if you will, to pull people in. We have a zone located, I guess, just west of Hammond's Crossing and just east over towards the Coal Mountain area. And it's a great zone. The planning staff actually led the effort to pull that together and get the zone approved by the Georgia Department of Community Affairs with the support of our commissioners. And the reason I say it's significant, in that area, before that zone was created, there were roughly, I think last check we did was about 7% occupancy rates. That was several years ago. Now, fast forward to now, they're almost at a 100% occupancy level. Now here's the trick about this whole thing. Not really a trick, but the interesting tidbit. A lot of the companies who were interested in the zone and actually moved to the area because they were interested in applying for those tax credits haven't used the tax credit. The reason being, after folks moved to Forsyth, they end up recognizing that our taxes, our property taxes here, are on average significantly lower than our surrounding communities. So before they even apply for a tax credit in their property taxes on the local side, they're recognizing that they're reaping significant benefits just from the move itself. And that again goes back to help productivity and improve where they can put other forms of capital investment. But going back to your question, in terms of the northern end, the end result though, even though a lot of companies haven't applied for that zone, has been that it's attracted companies here. In an area where we once had a significant underdevelopment, we now have almost 100% occupancy levels, which is phenomenal. There's a great company over there in that area in the zone called Specialty Appliances. They manufacture orthodontic equipment, and as a result of some of the things that they've been able to save, they've actually been able to make significant investments in equipment. Now, the reason when you start thinking about how all that works, as they make those investments in equipment, they can therefore hire new individuals to train them on that equipment. And that's where we can start bringing in our partners like the Near Technical College to offer some training resources to them, and the Georgia Department of Labor to help with recruiting, and even offering some job training tax credits to the Georgia Mountains Regional Commission. So it all comes together. But I think the zone is one of the key things that's helping to push people here.
I don't know if this is a fair question, but who is our biggest competitor for jobs? Right. Would it be Alpha Runner right down the street, or would it be another?
Texas. We go up against areas in Texas that are usually similar to us, located about 45 minutes outside of a major city, moderate to high income households. And then we also compete actively with a lot of partners overseas. When people say that it's a global economy, it really is. When we're fighting for projects and really trying to speak to the value of our community, one of the strongest things that we can really put forth is that we very much understand what it means to compete in the global marketplace. Things like being able to offer connectivity to Hartsfield, Atlanta, Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport, as well as to the Port of Savannah, resonate more so, I think, than they ever have at any other point in human history. I think it's often thought, you know, our competitors are our neighbors, but we're really in a different market right now. Oddly enough, our greatest allies lately have been our neighbors. I work really closely with Nick Messino over in Gwinnett. Nick's a great guy. We partnered up on Hisense's relocation. They were looking to expand into a facility that was located really on the border of our two communities, and they found a great location over there right on the border by Johns Creek, and we were able to work with our two jurisdictions and even pull in our local fire department and everyone to partner up on it. We do the same thing with Misty Martin over in Cherokee County, and then our partners in Alpharetta. And I'm sure y'all have seen it, there's a lot of talk about the growth that's happened on the south side of the county, especially on the commercial side of things. A lot of our international companies have really found a home in the Bluegrass Lakes Industrial Park, where Scientific Games and Hans Grohe and Lonza are. And then right across the street, you've got Technology Drive off the McFarland Parkway, where Siemens is located, their regional office. It's where they're building a lot of the new Atlanta streetcars that are going to go in. But as all of those things kind of take shape, going back to what you had mentioned, the biggest factor we've noticed is our neighbors are being very beneficial. If we're having challenges in the workforce, for instance, we can often lean on some of our neighboring communities to help offset some of that, and it becomes a retention issue. So a lot of us are starting to work together a lot more as a region. I think that's unique also, I should say that.
When you said problems in the workforce, do you mean not enough workers?
Yeah, I'll touch on that. There's, throughout the nation, there is a very large issue that is growing. There is a void of technically trained workers, and when I refer to technically trained workers, I refer to individuals who are trained in doing PLC or engineering work, technicians who can handle robotics and have a firm background that usually consists of at least 2 years of training before they take a position.
He's doing great.
You all right, Ethan?
Yeah.
You want any apples?
Yes, please.
All right.
Yeah. Okay.
I love apples because they have juice inside.
All right, you got to remember the rule, though, okay?
Can I test it first?
There they are.
I'll plug this back in for you. There we go.
Ooh.
Looking good, man. Alright. Sorry about it.
No problem.
So as those positions, technically trained workers, start coming online, the interesting thing is there's actually not a pool to draw from. So although there's rising unemployment levels throughout the nation, there's actually not a pool to fill these technically trained jobs. There's a great report in the Wall Street Journal that had actually cited that there's about 600,000 technically trained positions that are remaining unfilled in the midst of rising unemployment rates. Now, you take that and put it into a local snapshot, and on the local level, we're very blessed in that we have a $13 million training facility here in Lanier Tech. It's outstanding. But the key factor, though, is if these companies who are now interested in expanding and now have voiced that they want to grow their companies in Forsyth County, if they're not able to find the talent, then they're forced to either outsource the production, or they're forced to go to a location in which the talent exists. So the answer to that, oddly enough, has started to come from our European companies. In Europe, there isn't necessarily as strong of a push as there is here in the United States for students at the high school level to enter into college. There's more of a focus on a trade. Most folks are able to offer up most companies are able to offer apprenticeships where they can take on a student who's entering their sophomore year in high school, train them over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, and then groom them for a position within the company while paying for their training at a local trade school. Now, what's unique about that is after that student graduates high school, they now pretty much are at the mid-level position. They're pretty much a mid-level employee within the company, or they can go on to another company on their own and take all the skill sets that they have with them. We're looking at doing something similar in Forsyth County. There's a great initiative that the school system has started to launch, and it's being done through a pilot program with Siemens, where they're actually taking students who have a strong engineering background and really want to go into that as a trade and gearing them into Siemens. And Siemens has actually helped the school system to craft curriculums around their production cycle. So what you do on the factory floor now becomes the work plan and the syllabus for the classroom. You all right? Good job. As the production cycle gets taught in the classroom, the students can take that information, go back to Siemens in a dual enrollment situation, and actually implement what they've learned, test out what they've obtained in the classroom. Now, the next step is then for Lanier Tech to offer support, and they're beginning to look at ways to do that now, where training curriculums can get put in place. And that's where we can start drawing down tax credits to offset the cost of doing this, so that way it really doesn't offer a major impact to businesses on the cost side. And we train our students. So long story short, the end result is where there once was a void in technically trained workers, we now have a steady supply of local students who can fill these jobs. So it doesn't just become a job, it becomes a local job. And then that student can go back and train another student as they take on a management position within the company. So it's something that's groundbreaking. It's just being launched. Bruce Hagenow, who's the president of MetCam, and he's also the head of the Manufacturing Society of Forsyth County, has taken this on as his go-to project for 2014. Thought is that if this is launched by 2014 in the summer, that they can probably create a best practices situation where other communities can really look at the model and try to duplicate it themselves.
So what can the next logical question to Wayne, the folks helping the companies here, what can the Planning Commission, I heard what the Planning Department is doing to help, but what can the Planning Commission do to help attract more business here?
Well, I think there's two things that come to mind, three really. The first is what you're doing now. I've reached out to several of y'all just on different situations and just asked if you could make yourselves available, and y'all have. Just to talk to companies at times and even creating the opportunity for me to come in and just kind of share some insights. This is something that gets forgotten. I do have to tell you, being able to have this kind of a dialogue is key. But the second thing, I think, which gets a little bit more important, is really on the development side. And several developers have actually raised it as a caution that there's some key properties throughout the county that are currently zoned commercial, but have the potential to be rezoned into residential. And although the average deal, our closure rate is very phenomenal. 36% is something to be happy about. The time it takes to reach that closure point from start to finish is beginning to take a little bit longer, just because companies want to measure 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, and then cut once. As a result, the length of time it might take to close a project, in the midst of trying to close that project, the land could actually get rezoned, and that's a challenge.
So I guess it might be fair to say that some of the stuff that's going on and getting these projects moving through the system, it takes just a little bit longer than some of our neighbors and stuff. And I also heard, I heard you say that we're the richest county in the state.
We're 13th wealthiest in the country.
13th wealthiest in the country.
Yes, sir.
So that would lead me to believe that we should be able to afford to provide a little more money for our planning department from the Board of Commissioners to kind of cut that time, you know, to provide them with more people to help cut that time and help you guys.
Well,
so you think it might be an idea for us to try to help get some support for the planning department here so they can support you?
Well, I will say, I think it would not be my place to make a decision about what funding in the county government should be allocated.
Well, would more bodies in the planning department help the Chamber of Commerce, or is that?
I think
I'm not trying to put Tom or anybody else on the spot. I'm just trying to get to the truth.
I think I get where you're going towards it. I can answer that by saying I think that right now the staff is doing a phenomenal job at being responsive to the needs that the development community is asking for.
Our planning department is tops.
When we have run into snags and situations, I can't tell you how meaningful it is to have the staff, Tom in particular, to have you to his horn, to actually show up in person and talk something out and work out what the difference is in a particular deal might be. And even in times where the company might be at fault. But the fact that communication one-on-one happened helps to resolve the issue in a very civil way. But going back to your question, I think resource allocation really is the name of the game these days. Every community is having to figure out how to do more with less. I think our community has done a phenomenal job at that.
But we're the richest.
But if resources could help, yes, that's without question. That moonwalk enough for that one.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't wanna.
So you didn't.
If you go any further, I might.
You didn't give us number three of what we could do.
Oh yeah, the third thing. Oddly enough, this is the thing that often gets forgotten. But I just said, listen. You'd be surprised how many companies would love for you all to meet them, go on a factory tour, and kind of hear what some of their growth targets are. And expansion goals, even in terms of land acquisition. A great example in the city of Cumming, Automation Direct was really looking at about a 23-acre expansion, which is beautiful. They're creating a campus right here in the heart of our community. But there's other companies who are looking at doing similar things down the line within the county. And I think the chance to listen to them and really hear what their challenges are from them directly really would be meaningful. I'm happy to serve as that conduit. That's the role of the chamber. When I say I mean our organization. But hearing it directly from them, it's key. And we would love to help facilitate some introductions to both the developers who are recognizing that there's some challenges with rezoning, and then the companies who would love to just chat a little bit about what some of their growth plans are.
What do you think is the biggest, one of the biggest struggles that you have when a company decides not to come here? What are some of the things that the reasons why they don't come here?
Everybody wishes that Cracker Barrel was bigger, I gotta tell you. One of the big things, I think, that is the pink elephant in the room is transportation. There's a lot of discussions about the different arteries in the community that go east to west, and then also the arteries that funnel into Georgia 400. But let's remember, from a commercial standpoint, if all roads lead to 400, improvements on the arteries just lead to a greater backup in the main vessel. 400 is our direct connection to the airport. There are so many companies that rely on getting goods down to the airport for transit by 7 o'clock every day. All right?
Did you hurt our wall?
Oh no!
I think Daddy needed.
It's all right.
I do it too.
Sorry.
Well, I think that I really appreciate your what you've had to say, and I think it helps. I've been sort of promoting for a while, trying to get a little more funds for the planning department, and here's a good example where it can help the community as a whole. So I appreciate you, your comments on that.
Well, with the 400, there's one other major thing I just want to thank you as I reach for milk. With 400, one of the key things to bear in mind, and then I'll wrap up if God don't mind.
Hey,
I
got you some milk.
I know.
That's how I sound getting on board.
There you go.
There we go.
Alright. We're almost done. 5 more minutes, okay?
Your father's done a great job. He really did, but I know he couldn't have done it without you.
A good helper.
You did a good job, too.
But we recently did a survey with our local businesses to talk about really what the impact of transportation has on their business. And we didn't know what the feedback would be, but really about 30% of the businesses reported that it has a retention issue within their company, meaning that as employees travel from outside of Forsyth into Forsyth County, they really look at 400 as being a reason for them to actually seek other positions, just because the hassle of going up 400 and back again really becomes too cumbersome and bears down on their personal lives. So from a transportation standpoint, one of the things that companies have asked us to communicate on their behalf is that it really does become an employee retention factor. And it's the forgotten thing. Although we look at transit in terms of our ability to get to and from certain points and locations, in terms of being able to retain employees and create new jobs, that's what we're here for. That's where economic development is rooted. But if I could communicate one thing, I'd just say 400 is probably one of the more meaningful things we all could pay attention to.
And that's the state. Your representatives.
Do you have any data on the percentage of people who live here and work out of the county?
It used to be pretty much a bedroom model, like 70-30. But honestly, it's gone closer towards 60-40, and some surveys even say more so towards 50-50. I say 50-50 by when I'm stuck in traffic coming the other way. Yeah. But a lot of companies are noticing that also when we do our focus groups.
Curious about young professionals and culture. I know that the company that I work for, almost everybody that we get are either Auburn or Georgia Tech grads. And right now, almost every one of them that are under 30 actually live in Atlanta and commute north rather than live in south. But is there a problem with getting like college grads in this area because of the absence of a school? Or
two things. First, I just want to make sure everyone recognizes that we do have, in fact, the University of North Georgia here in our community, which is a new addition, and we're just starting to see the fruits of what that means for our community. But perhaps in terms of pushing our community forward, in terms of growth and the leap, that is one of the more meaningful factors, having that university there and the programming that they offer. Can't stress that enough. Second thing, though, in response to your question, when people discuss young urban professionals or yuppies, for instance, the big thing that they bear in mind isn't that most young urban professionals have higher levels of spending power, typically go into middle management and offer white collar jobs, and that's the thing everybody knows. But the thing that's forgotten is that there's two groups of young urban professionals. There's young urban single professionals, and then there's young urban professionals with families. Your young urban professionals with families typically leave city centers and go towards kind of your sprawled areas that still have a bit of an urban core, kind of like a Roswell, but then grow into areas where there's high quality of life, moderate to high income households. And as they mature in their professional careers, they seek that. And we, oddly enough, are just that. We are the area that they see. The thing that we've had a challenge with, though, is being the area in which they work. We've always had that group move here to live and grow their families. It's been a base for us. I think when I started here in Forsyth County, the average age of the individuals here was about 35 ballpark. But again, it's because we're attracting that group. What's unique now is we're now recognizing that we are able to offer job opportunities to that group. So middle management positions that can lead to higher level positions, positions within international companies that will train them and grow them. And I think as we improve that sector of our commercial base, we'll start to see more of that group move in. But that's my take on it.
The reason why I was saying I was curious, just from the business development standpoint, because I know some companies just say, well, we got to have the ability to retain people right out of school. They want that. So.
Well, there's another factor, and hopefully I can wrap up if you don't mind after that. There's another factor we look for, which is the presence of the amenities that that group wants. Restaurants are a very big piece of that, believe it or not. Currently in Forsyth County, we're about $60 million underserved in terms of our restaurant supply. What that means is that, and that data was obtained, I should mention, through the Nielsen Claritas system. They do an over-under supply report that they call the RMP, Retail Opportunity Gap Analysis. The 2013 version of that report shows that on average, or not on average, but in a year, our residents spend about $60 million in restaurants outside of Forsyth County. So for us, that, as we look to grow the commercial tax digest, is low-hanging fruit. Part of the reason, though, that's taken place is because we need more Cracker Barrels, but part of the reason is that we've just grown faster than a lot of retailers have been able to recognize, and they typically look at census data. Whereas if you look at our, as you all know, the permitting numbers, I think Tom had last report he had given us, I mean, we've already crossed the 2,000 single family household threshold for single family residential permits. That being the case, the folks who need to know that data don't know it. And that's where the chamber's job comes in, is communicating the value of our growth market. As we grow, we have to make sure that the retailers and restaurateurs who are looking to grow in our market know that our market is growing too. And it's starting to happen, but next year we're launching a very ambitious plan called Business First, which will allow for us to essentially double the amount of commercial investment that gets created in our community, and retail and restaurants are a very large part of that.
Come on.
It's sleeping.
Thank you.
Well, thank y'all so much for allowing me to speak to y'all this evening, and for allowing my helper to join us too. We had a great time. And if we can ever be of any assistance, just feel free to give us a ring. And like I mentioned, we're pleased to partner with Tom and all that the staff does here, from assisting with our commercial growth all the way down to helping with the small inspection and zoning needs. It's a great partnership.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming, Randall.
Thank you. Very informative. Nice job working without the PowerPoint, too. It's a real pro, and they can pull it off without a PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Good job, bro.
Okay, next on the agenda is Planning Department Applicant Processing Presentation, Mr. Brown.